Hello, welcome to Lemon Studios, home of the Lemmy versus Limey games. I am your host, Zeke Lamone, and today, Lemmy and Limey, you know what? I'm done with this era. I think I'm gonna cut it. Yeah, I'm just gonna cut it. Hello, welcome to Lemon Studios, home of the Lemmy versus Limey games. I am your official Zeke Lamone, and today, Lemmy and Limey will be facing off in Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse was directed by Rodney Rothman, Peter Ramsey, and Bob Persichetti. I hope I'm saying your name right. This movie had everything going against it, from both audiences and critics saying that you can't make a Spider-Man movie where Peter Parker is not the main Spider-Man, and you're going to make it animated? We already have three live actions. This movie is going to bomb. Well, after a 97-93% rating on critics and audiences, and making $350 million worldwide on the $90 million budget, and to cap it off, a 2018 Oscar win for Best Animated Movie, I would say we are wrong. But where will it land on the Lemon Scale? Can Limey finally get a win, even though that this official's favorite superhero is Spider-Man? Well, let's find out. Act 1 kicks off with the introduction of Peter Parker, voiced by Chris Pine. He gives the typical spirit of Spider-Man, you know, bit by radioactive spider, blah, 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 blah. But what's really great here is the visual storytelling. We are being shown that we are not in our world. We're in a different dimension, even though it's animated. You can tell from the different product placements, such as instead of Coca-Cola, it's Coca-Soda. Later on, we see NYPD is actually... PDNY, it's flipped. Just a bunch of different things, and also during this opening montage, we see the Sam Raimi trilogy being retold, but in different ways. There's the iconic kiss, but this time Mary Jane's upside down. So many other different things to show that this is not our original Peter. So I have to give a Lemmy to start off because it's just so subtle, you know? It's just so subtle, and I love it. Although we do get this scene.
We don't really talk about this.
Then why bring it up? We are then introduced to our main protagonist, Miles Morales, voiced by Shameik Moore. And needless to say, he needs to be put in check because it's the first day of school and he hasn't even packed yet. And that is bad, bad nevertheless. The reason that he has to pack for school is because he won a contest to Brooklyn Visions Academy, a boarding school. Although he's reluctant to really go at first because he misses his old school where he was very popular. And this whole introduction to Miles is just tremendous. Is very upbeat and just makes him really likable and relatable, a point to Lemmy. We also get to see the relationships that he has with other people, including his dad. His dad is very strict, but you can tell, hey, he wants to connect with his son. And Miles is very distant towards him, and he wants to be more like his uncle, Aaron. And here I have to talk about the animation, because this is when I really first noticed it. It's a little blurry in some cases, and it's really hard to focus. Now, that could be just a me thing, but I also read up that some other people have some problems with it, and I can always appreciate animators going a different route. It does, it's completely different, not traditional at all. Really gives that comic book feel, but again, it was just really hard to focus and really settle into the movie, so therefore I have to give a Limey. Once they get to the school, Officer Davis, voiced by Brian Henry, tells Miles that he loves him, and Miles is like, yeah, I know, but he will not be allowed to go back into the school until Officer Davis makes him say that he loves him back. And this is very funny, and it's also very pivotal to Officer Davis's arc in the story, so therefore, there's a Lemmy. We then experience Miles' first day slash week of school. During this week, he is running late for, I can assume, science class because they are watching a video on lead scientist Dr. Olivia something. I'm sure she's not important to the story anyway. This is where Miles meets Gwen, who is voiced by Hailee Steinfeld. They have a conversation, so therefore, naturally, Miles has a crush on her. And for advice, he goes to his uncle Aaron, who is voiced by two-time Academy Award winner Mahershala Ali. Aaron tells him to talk less, smile more, and say, hey, and it will work. They then go underground to display some of Miles' art. And after he gets done, he gets bit by a radioactive spider, and man, that bite must really hurt. I mean, it's life-changing. Oh, nope, just a simple slap. It didn't hurt that much. I really love how they didn't amp up the bite here. The next day, Miles has gone through the changes. He's thinking it's puberty, but we all really know what's really going on here. He sees Gwen, and he attempts to do the shoulder touch, but it goes terribly wrong, and he touches her hair. and that the only way for them to be separated now because he can't seem to let go is for Gwen to cut her hair. Well, there goes any chance of being her in this movie, Miles. His anxiety is all the way up because he's having a bad feeling and he's losing his grip. That when he gets back to his room, he realizes it's not puberty, it's Spider-Man. He then goes back to check on the spider, but stumbles across a fight between Spider-Man and the Green Goblin. And I must say, I am not a huge fan of the design of the Green Goblin. But this is also where we meet our main heel of the story, Kingpin, who is voiced by Liev Schreiber, and this is a design that I do really like. Peter is then crushed into the collider, which brings all the other Spider-Man into this dimension. This leaves Peter pretty messed up as the whole thing kind of collapsed, and Miles goes to check up on him, and Peter tells him, hey, put on a mask so that you can protect your loved ones. He also tells Miles that he needs to finish what he started and hands him the chip to destroy the collider. Miles agrees and then goes and hides as he watches Kingpin kill Spider-Man. This is later confirmed when Miles' parents are watching the news to end Act 1. Act 2 kicks off with the city of New York mourning the death of Spider-Man. Miles buys a costume from Stan Lee, and here at Lemon Studio, Stan Lee is always a Lemmy. Miles then decides to jump off a building because he saw that in a comic book. But in the process of that, he breaks the goober, and he goes to Peter's grave to tell him, hey, I'm sorry, I messed up, and I failed. But wait, Miles, who is that? Peter? But wait, how? It turns out this is actually Peter B. Parker, voiced by Jake Johnson from our dimension, Spider-Man. You can tell by the Coca-Cola product and some of the other montages throughout. This Peter's life has had a much more difficult life than the Peter that we first met, because Aunt May has died and Mary Jane has left him. And I really enjoy this montage because this really gives the spirit of who Peter Parker is. After the montage, a chase sequence presumes, and it's fun, but it's really a because movie kind of chase scene, so I have to give a line to that. And once Peter actually wakes up and comes to, he is reluctant to help Miles, but then agrees after Miles makes him feel guilty. Their first stop is Alchemex, and while they are trying to hatch up a plan, they make a meme in the process. Once they sneak in, they hear your typical villain stakes and point to both Lemmy and Limey for being self-aware, but still being your typical villain stakes. And once they sneak in, Dr. Olivia comes in, voiced by Katherine Hahn. And this is when we finally learn her last name, Octavius. Yep, she is Doc Ock. Great twist! A chase sequence then follows, and this one actually feels very organic. This is also the time when Peter thinks it's the best time to teach Miles how to swing. This is also where we learn that Gwen is actually a spider person this whole entire time. We also learn Kingpin's motive is to bring back his family to life. Very understandable motive. After meeting Spider-Gwen officially, this makes Miles ask the important question. Just how many spider people are there? Well, we find out at Aunt May's house. There's Penny Parker, who is voiced by Kimiko Glenn, Spider-Man Noir, who is voiced by Nicolas Cage, and Spider-Ham, who is voiced by John Mulaney. Aunt May is voiced by Lily Tomlin, and she is explaining how they all came here to find their way back home. Man, what a freaking cast. Peter is trying to pump up Miles with all his cool new powers, such as turn invisible and shoot lightning, but Miles tells him he can't do it on command. The group is trying to force Miles into trying to do his powers, but this pushes Miles to actually just leave. So he turns to the one man that he can trust, good old Uncle Aaron, sir. And he's writing him a note because Uncle Aaron is not home. But then the Prowler shows up in Aaron's apartment, and it's revealed that Aaron is the Prowler. Now, for some, this was obvious, for those who read the comics or, you know, just simple storytelling. But it still does that oomph to it, and it does its job well, so I give a Lemmy to that. Also, Miles, again, is doing his powers on command, even though he can't, and he won't be able to later. Miles runs back to go tell the others about his hardcore origin story. But it turns out that he was followed in a big fight, presumes. The Prowler then chases Miles all the way up to the ceiling and he catches him, getting ready to kill him. But then once Miles reveals that it's him, Uncle Aaron decides to throw away his shot. But Kingpin does not, and he kills Uncle Aaron. Miles' dad then shows up on the crime scene, and all he sees is Spider-Man over his brother's body. But Miles again is able to do his invisibility on command, even though he won't be able to later and escape. Now, what follows here is some really, really good scenes. Miles gets back to his room, and then his team shows up, and they have a heart-to-heart to him. But then Peter tells him, hey, you're off the team. And, you know, he's just trying to get him to do his powers on command, but of course Miles is not able to. Now, for some people, they're just like, I mean, he was just doing them earlier. They just couldn't really believe it. And you know what? I can give y'all that. I can give y'all a limey for that. But for most people, it did its job. Like, it was really heartfelt. It was really, like, it just had that oomph to it. So I have to give a limey because it does its job well. It really does. And then after that, his dad shows up, you know, and he finally completes his arc. The dad does. You know, letting Miles be, you know, he's not forcing him to open the door. And, you know, he's just letting him be. Like, he can see a shadow. He knows Miles is there, but, you know, he's just letting him, hey, just letting him know that he loves him and why he's so hard on him and all of that. It's just a really good scene, and it honestly really made me think of my dad. My dad is a hard ass, and, you know, he will admit that. He will. And I remember when me and him had a talk like this at one point, so it affected me in a special way. And I wasn't the only one, because I saw this movie, I think, 4 times in theaters, and I think on the 3rd time, I want to say, I was sitting next to a dad and a son, and while this scene played, and at the end of it, the son just looked over and said, I love you, Dad. So, again, another really heartfelt moment here. And this is what gives Miles the urge to finally break free from the web, and now he's able to use his powers on command to end Act 2. What's up, Danger? Act 3 kicks off with Miles getting a real suit from Aunt May, while the other spider people are going to Kingpin's party that is in honor of Spider-Man. Yeah, it's pretty tasteless, but hey, it makes it easy for them to sneak in due to the waiters dressed like Spider-Man. They get to the Collider, but of course the bad guys know that they are there, and another fight breaks out. And it's a really, really good, really good fight scene. The only problem I have with it, though, Miles never used his lightning once. I mean, it could just save a lot of time, man. The battle is now over, and all the Spider-Men go back to their respective dimensions, except for Peter, because Kingpin is not done with them yet. Peter tries to sacrifice himself, but Miles says, no, I'm the captain now. And then Peter finally goes back to his dimension after a brief talk. Now, this is how you successfully put someone over. Peter wasn't dumbed up. He wasn't weak or anything. He was still the same Peter that we know and love. It was just Miles' time. And it just felt so organic, and I absolutely loved it. Alright, folks, it is final boss time, and Kingpin has control for most of this match until Miles is able to successfully use the shoulder touch because it is truly electrifying. As the movie ends, Miles has finally embraced that he is Spider-Man, and after the credits, we get a nice nod to the most iconic Spider-Man meme.
Whoa,
what the?
I'm Spider-Man. I need you to come with
Who
me.
Who the heck are you?
I just told you that. Listen, I'm from the future.
Dare you point at me?
You were pointing first.
That's rude to point.
You're being very rude. You're not even believing what
Which
I'm saying.
Which one pointed first?
Spider-Man pointed first, obviously.
You're pointing at me right now
not
as you say that.
You're
look
pointing.
At you.
I'm
look
just
at
pointing
your
at your
finger. Look at your
which
finger
is
right
different
now.
Than
what
normal
is
pointing.
You are pointing.
You haven't
at me.
seen
you're
pointing
accusing
until
me
I get
of
through
pointing
with you, and
while
then
you're
you'll
pointing.
Know.
Now, it may look bad for our lime, but the points are not done yet. Let's get to overall thoughts and standout moments. Spider-Verse was a movie that was destined to fail, and with that, it probably created the most spirited Spider-Man movie of all time. Our first standout performance goes to the attention to detail in the animation, from the separation of the dimensions to each animation style of the Spider-Person, and also showing Olivia Octavius super early on. Absolutely love that. 5 points to Lemmy. Our second standout performance goes to the voice acting overall. Voice acting is an art form that is not appreciated enough, and seeing all these people who have great work in person give it their all using just their voice was great to see. Or should I say hear? 5 more points to Lemmy for that. Our final standout performance goes to the script from Phil Lode and Rodney Rothman. They, the blend of just using jokes and seriousness and having those jokes actually turn out to be important character beats later, absolutely love that as well. 5 more points to Lemmy for that. And the overall message of Spider-Verse, well, I would say is said throughout the whole entire finale. It's a leap of faith. Life is a leap of faith. Because you really never know what's going to happen unless you actually do it. It took until the end of the movie for Miles to finally realize that, and also for Peter. I wouldn't be surprised if in the sequel, Mary Jane turned down Peter. Because it is a leap of faith, and we doesn't mean that it's always going to have a happy ending. So this is how the lemon scale works. If I don't like the movie, it's a sour lemon. If I don't like it, but hey, there's some good to it, it's expired store-bought lemonade. If I liked it, but there's a lot of problems to it, It's just store-bought lemonade. If I like it, it's fine. It's a movie. Don't really have much of a opinion on it. It's just lemonade. If I really liked it, but there's still some problems, it's a freshly squeezed lemonade. And if it's a top-notch movie, 10 out of 10, have to be really nitpicky to find the problems, it's a strawberry lemonade, because that is the best kind of lemonade. And with a score of 33 to 10 favoring Lemmy, that makes Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse freshly squeezed lemonade. And that'll do it for me here, folks, at Lemon Studios, and I hope I see y'all here next time. Make sure to like, subscribe, and comment. Do y'all like Spider-Verse? What are some of y'all's favorite moments? Please let me down in the comments below. Later.